So thank you all for joining. Today, in our fourth workshop, we're going to be discussing developing and issuing the request for proposal. So just a reminder of where we are in the cohort process. The first three workshops really focused on just developing the right community and financial partnerships in order to start thinking and developing what campaign goals that each city would like to prioritize. And then today, we're really going to be focusing in the RFP development, since that's a precursor to a lot of the other workshops later on. So we have three desired outcomes for participants today. The first is to understand the key components of a Solarize RFP. And then after understanding those components, start drafting your own campaign-specific RFP in the breakout session. And lastly, deciding who's going to be releasing the RFP and how it will be advertised. And those specific desired outcomes enabled us to form our agenda for today. So after we do what we've done in the past with some quick introductions and answering a check-in question, we'll jump into the heart of the workshop today, which is how to develop the RFP and the specific components there. So I will be presenting the project overview and scope of work components of the RFP with some Q&A and expert insights afterwards. And then Tushar will be discussing the proposal requirements and evaluation section with some time for questions after that as well. We'll have about half an hour for communities to be in their own specific breakout and working through the RFP template that we've developed. And lastly, we'll just do a quick kind of report out exercise and discuss the next steps for this specific cohort. So now that we've gone through that quick check-in, time to get into the meat of the workshop today on the RFP components. So this is actually a question that had come up in the check-in group that I was with, was how applicable will, you know, this content today be to my work with Solar United Neighbors, because they have their own template. And yeah, the first thing I would say is that Solarize and Solar Co-op RFPs come in a lot of different formats and content. So we're just utilizing our RFP template is for simplicity and to just kind of standardize the content in one easily understandable manner. But for those that have their own template, definitely, you know, still use your own template and just take the lessons learned from today and modify your template as you see fit, because a lot of the content should still be transferable. But what we'll be referencing a lot through this workshop today is this inclusive Solarize campaign RFP template that our team has developed. And we've taken best practices that we've seen in the Solar United Neighbors, Solar Crowdsource RFP template, the Solarize Philly templates, et cetera, to try to standardize into one format so that we can kind of be talking about the same things as we go through this. And this template has a lot of the work already done for you as far as the boilerplate language that's in there. And it highlights in certain sections where you would need to modify this template in order to make it specific to your campaign. So we'll have time at the end for you all to dive into the template. But for now, we're going to organize this workshop's content through the four sections that are in our template, which are the project overview section, the scope of work, the proposal requirements, and the proposal evaluation. So these are the core components we'll be discussing today. And we'll have an icon at the bottom of every slide in case you get confused and are not sure where exactly that content falls within our template. We'll have an icon at the bottom letting you, kind of reminding you as to where the content falls. So first, diving into those first two sections on project overview and scope of work. So the project overview section, the real objective of it is to concisely provide the necessary information for installers to determine their interest. So after reading that overview, they should know whether they're interested in reading more and potentially bidding on the project. So in our template, this includes things like the project purpose, partners, goals and strategies, the project kind of details themselves, the timeline, and then the specific installer benefits. And the first four sections there, we've kind of covered already in the first couple workshops on goals and strategies and partners and purpose of this. So what I'd like to focus on is the timeline and reminding you all about the installer benefits that you can include. So in the project timeline, it should really include all of the relevant RFP deadlines and the project dates. So I've got an example here, and I'll walk through this table kind of row by row. Initially, you know, you'll obviously want to state when the RFP released and then the deadline for proposers to submit their RFP proposal. And that's typically 4 to 5 weeks after the release date. That can be shorter or longer, but typically it falls in that timeline. So for an example, if you were to release your RFP on February 1st, you'd likely want the deadline to maybe be around March 1st. You'd also want to include things like when installer interviews will be happening, if that's something you're interested in, when the actual selected installer or installers will be announced and onboarded. So in this example now, you're kind of getting to the end of March in the selection and onboarding of the installers. And the last part of this table that we have in the template is when the campaign launches and ends, as well as the deadline for customers to sign contracts and for the installers to actually install the systems. So in this example, I've got the campaign launching April 12th and then running for about 4 months. And then the contract signing deadline being about a month after that, which would provide the installer about 3.5 or 4 months to get all of the installations installed before December 31st, 2021, in order for residents to secure the 22% investment tax credit. And I think this could be actually an interesting exercise during the 30 minutes of work time later to work backwards and say, okay, if we want the deadline to be December 31st for installations to happen, then when does the campaign have to end and start? And then when does the RFP likely have to be released? So while it may sound like, you know, we have a full year to run all these campaigns and everything, actually issuing the RFP by early February at the latest might be required in order for the installations to happen before the end of the year. And that 15 to 20 weeks that's listed there for how long it typically takes installers to install all of those systems after the contracting deadline, that depends on if you're choosing one installer or multiple installers, how many systems are you actually going to be installed, and things like that. So it is a little bit specific to each campaign, but something that you'll want to provide enough time for. The other part here is listing installer benefits. So for installers that have not participated in a past solar co-op or Solarize campaign, sometimes it's helpful just to remind installers what's the benefit of bidding into this proposal. And one is reduced customer acquisition costs. So if they're the selected installer, they're going to secure not only a higher overall volume of systems, but increasing their deal completion rates. So reducing their customer acquisition costs, getting their brand recognized in the community. So even after the campaign, becoming a more trusted residential solar installer if they're selected as part of this campaign. And lastly, just stimulating the local solar market. So being part of the solar education and solar contagion aspect in emerging markets like low and moderate income and communities of color, as well as if you're piloting solar app as part of this, streamlining the solar permitting process, that should help all installers going forward to streamline that and reduce their associated costs. Okay, so then moving into the second section of our template, the scope of work. So this section should outline the responsibilities and requirements for not only the campaign, for not only yourselves, so the campaign coordinator, but also the selected installer, as well as any installation specific requirements. So I'm going to focus on those first two sections on the campaign coordinator and selected installer responsibilities. So first on the campaign coordinator responsibilities, a lot of the topics are things like management and outreach, what marketing you'll provide, how you'll be recruiting residents, what financing options you might be providing or institutions you'll be partnering with, as well as permitting and interconnection. So a couple questions to consider as you modify the highlighted part of our template is how many educational events will you host and what outreach materials will you provide? Because that'll give the installer a bit of an understanding of, okay, how much marketing and outreach really is this campaign going to do and help get the installers access to more installations. For resident recruitment, what information will you request from participants when they sign up? So likely their address, but also will you be asking about their roof type or age, their home ownership status, so if they're a renter or owner, any income questions, if you're going to be specifying LMI specific pricing, potentially race, et cetera. And from that information, how detailed will your pre-screen of participants be prior to providing their information to that selected installer? So if kind of on the end of the spectrum of the least amount of information, you might just be asking, are you a homeowner? And that would be kind of the bare bones of pre-screening participants. But you could also ask about roof age and roof condition, as well as providing or performing some type of very high level remote shading analysis of their roof prior to giving their information to the selected installer. And I believe that's what Solar United Neighbors does as well. So interested to hear Corey's reflection in a couple minutes. On the financing, just, you know, will you be partnering with a financial institution and or providing specific types of lending opportunities outside of what the selected installer can provide? And then lastly, on the permitting and interconnection, is there a possibility of your jurisdiction piloting solar app as part of the campaign to streamline permitting? And that decision does not have to be made when the RFP is released, but if it's something you're considering piloting, you would want to put that in there as a possibility. And then as Tushar will get to later, potentially requesting a better pricing if you end up piloting that new automated online permitting platform. Okay, so lastly, before I turn it over to questions and some expert reflections, on the installer responsibility section, it's really important to specify how quickly the selected installer has to perform the responsibilities. So a lot of these themes like internal campaign communications, customer outreach, site assessment, proposals and installations, a lot of that language is actually pretty boilerplate and not something you'll likely have to modify in the template, but what you will have to modify is how quickly they'll have to perform this. So for example, internal campaign communications, within how many business days should the installer respond to your internal communications and how often should they attend meetings and update tracking records? For things like customer outreach and education, within how many days should the installer contact participants after their information is made available and how many workshops must they attend? For the site assessment, within how many business days must the installer conduct a site visit after their initial contact and after the installer has done more of a detailed approval? For the proposal and contract, this is kind of moving down the line after the site visit, within how many days must the installer provide a custom proposal? So kind of the theme to a lot of those questions for those first four topics is, you know, within how many business days or how often must the installer do this? So the boilerplate language is there, but really specifying how quickly they have to perform their responsibilities is helpful. Okay, so that's all of the content that I have to present. Now we're going to take a couple minutes to hear from Corey Ramsden from Solar United Neighbors, as well as Don Moreland from Solar Crowdsource, to speak to their experience with their request for proposal process, especially on these first two sections, and then letting them answer any questions that come up as well as any questions that you all have for me. So I'll stop sharing my screen and allow Initially for Corey and Don to answer a couple questions that I had. And the first one really was just any initial reactions to that content, anything that really resonates to say, you know, yes, definitely agree on that one point. That's super important when considering developing those first two sections. So Don, it looks like you're already unmuted. So I'll go to you first and then we'll go to Corey after that.
No, I thought all of that looked really great. I think that explaining the benefits to the selected contractor is really important and something that you know, you want the contractor to be really excited about the campaign and about the opportunity to participate in it and to spell out what those benefits could be for that contractor, I think that's a takeaway for me. It's really important. One thing it's a little bit off topic, Ryan, but to the extent that the RFP is not being driven through the government entity or through the municipality, it can be done a little bit differently than mm-hmm. having to go by the municipal or the government entity procurement rules and through city councils and city attorneys and all of that kind of stuff. We have found to the extent you can get support from the local government, but not drive the RFP through that channel, you can really come out with a great outcome and have some of that flexibility at the same time. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thanks, Don. We'll actually get into that specific question of kind of the pros and cons of the local government issuing the RFP versus a community organization. So Tushar, we'll touch on that in a bit. So thanks for flagging that up front. Corey, any initial reactions on your end from that content?
Yeah, thank you. I agree with the points that Don just made. And I think with regard to the roles and responsibilities of the organizers, one area that I know we do and that I think installers appreciate, and as far as sort of explaining the value, is really preparing people for that engagement with the installer is something that that is valuable to them in their sales process. And that happens in a couple different ways for us. One is the roof review, which you mentioned, and just giving a sort of a basic thumbs up or, you know, thumbs down for folks to make sure we set expectations accordingly for folks that may don't have a good property for solar, but also ones that do. And then the second part is, you know, we do this, and this is something to consider for, you know, for folks that are organizing these, is just to the extent that you are able to engage your partners and people who are supporting the group to do sort of pre-support, pre-education for participants before they talk to the installer. We do a series of webinars with solar information sessions, as well as circulating materials to participants ahead of time, just to make sure they're ready. Installers appreciate that and it's valuable to them. So that's something just to consider. That's part of our standard process, but that's a pretty critical component of the pre-RFP phase that's important to extend even to the end of the group is that education component.
Yeah, I agree with Corey on that. We started doing bidder meetings. Once the RFP is released, then about a week to 10 days later, we'll have a bidder meeting where anybody interested in bidding can come learn more about the program and ask questions about the RFP. And that seems to go pretty smoothly and something that we're incorporating more. One other thing I forgot to mention before is on the proposals, when we're looking at the different requirements from the installer, I think, and this might be in the template, Ryan, so I don't want to get into it too much, but the proposals are obviously critically important, and there's ways that the installer can kind of manipulate the outcome of the proposal. And it's important that we get our eyes on a proposal during the RFP process. We would like them to send us a demo proposal so we can see, you know, this is a 25 year product. So there is some degradation. I don't want to get into it, but you have to calculate in the proposal how much energy degradation there is over that period of time, as well as what the utility escalation rate historically is and what it is in the future. And those are kind of just, those are variables that can easily be manipulated to make the proposals look better. And it's important for the campaign and the coalition to maintain credibility by making sure that they don't do that.
Yeah, and that's, you're really getting people excited for the next section, because that's actually what Tushar is going to talk about as well. One of the that third section on proposal requirements, Tushar is going to touch on kind of a standardized Excel file that hopefully standardizes across the board on that and speaks to some of those things you mentioned on. So yeah, thanks for previewing what's going to happen next.
Yeah, just a couple of thoughts, I think, on sort of, and I think some of we'll get to these a little bit later, but just placeholders. And then one, I think, which is probably appropriate for this section is also to the extent that you want to include non-solar but adjacent technologies is something to consider at this stage, which is whether you're going to include EV charger components and potentially storage. So there's some certain questions you want to ask, which we can get into later if folks have interest. But that's something we support in all of our co-ops, is the ability for us to be able to incorporate those questions when that's a priority for the partners and for the area where we're working. So there's some sort of special considerations there. And then the two things I think maybe that are placeholders for later with our model, and because it's such a sort of time limited process of 8 to 10 months, is we typically, we firmly don't do tiered pricing or only pick a single installer, because we find both of those things can be confusing for participants for a variety of reasons. And I know that's a variation with some of the other models. So just wanted to point that out, that's something that we do. We'd love to talk a little bit about that at some point as well.
Yeah, and we'll definitely get into some of those topics in the next section. But on that timeline portion, I know that the solar co-op timeline is also a little bit different than what I had mentioned there. So I wanted to just remind people that timeline is not set in stone for everyone, and every campaign has their own timeline that can be different from that. On the last part though, with how many months it typically takes for the installers to complete the installations after the contract signing deadline, Corey, what's been your experience with how long that usually takes? Is that kind of in the 3 to 4 month timeline that was listed, or can it sometimes be longer?
It can be faster. Ideally, we say 3 to 5 months. It's dependent on the municipality where they are quite a bit, because the things that extend it are permitting and interconnection processes and how long those take, which the installers don't have control over. But 3 to 5 months is pretty standard.
Yeah, ours is for residential, we provide 3 months. You're getting a lot of people signing up for the campaign before the enrollment deadline comes, so you need to give enough time for people to figure out their financing, HOA, historic district, stuff like that. Because the sales cycle is longer for commercial, we will allow even more time for any commercial prospects. So it's usually 3 months for residential and then 6 months for commercial.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I do know that after just speaking with a couple smaller local installers around the Colorado area, actually, that given the potential ending of the ITC at the end of 2021, that a lot of installers are already starting to kind of get backed up, and that those timelines might be a little bit stretched farther than what they might be typically. So just a recommendation to campaigns here, to get that RFP out the door as quick as you can, to enable your campaigns to start and finish in order in time for installers to really finish all of those installations before the end of 2021.
Ryan, can I mention one more thing that you just brought up? And you're exactly right. When we're approaching the end of the year, a lot of times the contract deadline will not be the same as the installation deadline. For folks who are really, where the tax credit is really important to them, then you need to work with the contractor as closely as you can to find out what is their contract deadline in order to get those installs in by the end of the year. Because a lot of times they'll, you're right, they'll be backed up and you need to allow some time for that. And it also gives you an extra deadline where, you know, you can get people motivated to mm-hmm. get their contracts in.
Yep. And it looks like we have a question from April for Corey. When picking a single installer instead of multiple installers, how do you account for different needs in terms of rooftop or ground mount installations?
We found that installers in areas where there are going to be ground mounts, that it's almost everybody is providing those options anyways. So it's really up to, for our model, the selection committee is making that choice, the volunteers, but they're aware of the needs of group members and they're picking accordingly. But it's pretty common to have installers provide multiple panel options as well as multiple installation types, including ground mount. So that's usually not a problem. And if there's an installer that doesn't have a ground mount option in a place where, excuse me, that's likely to be of interest or is an expressed interest, then that's a disadvantage for them in the selection process. So they probably wouldn't get picked, but that's up to the mm-hmm. up to the volunteers.
Yeah, and while in the RFP, you don't, April, you don't technically have to say we are going, or you probably shouldn't even say we're going to only select one installer. You can provide the flexibility in the RFP to say, you know, the city has the right to select either one installer or multiple installers, depending on the proposals that you get, to give you a little bit more flexibility once you receive the pricing and the offerings through those proposals. You can make that decision during the evaluation process on whether you'd want to pick one installer or multiple. And then one of the other, since I don't see any other questions in the chat, but feel free to interrupt me if anyone on the call has questions. But another question that Tushar and I had as we were developing some of this content was how much of an impact pre-screening participants has on a lower price that installers provide. And I know, Corey, you mentioned a little bit of this and Don as well. So interested in both of your perspectives on if a city is deciding how much information they want to ask for and how much they want to pre-screen participants before providing that information to the installer, how much of an impact might that have on getting a lower price?
Yeah, it's not something I think that is really quantifiable, but anecdotally, when we've talked to a lot of installers who've been selected, you know, over the hundreds that we've run, and they're used to paying for leads and paying for customers, and generally speaking, that doesn't really work out all that often for them. I mean, it does, but there has a very low conversion rate because they're not prepared. So having the more that we know about somebody, and the more we can sort of prep the customer before they talk to the installer, installers get that's valuable. And I think it incorporates that into the price, especially because we can tell them, you know, typically what a close rate is for a co-op, which for us is around 20 to 25% of people who join the group, some cases higher, that's what's likely to come from that. And they can plan accordingly because we have a track record and they understand we're helping people prepare before they've had that conversation with the installer.
Yeah, we work with the selected contractor to find out what kinds of information do they need in order to have a really informative meeting with the customer. So that usually includes utility bill information in our form. There's a place where you can upload your utility bills, or you can fill out a couple of fields to give us a general idea of what your energy load is. Or, you know, you can ask questions about your roof. How old is your roof? What is the material of the roof? Do you know what the pitch of your roof is? You know, anything, as much information that we can get in that intake process and get that over to the contractor, that helps the process along much faster. We do not screen, however. We let the contractors work with the customers and let them do the screening, because, you know, there might be some things that we miss, or there might be ways that the contractor can kind of mitigate shade, or they might have a new technology that can help a customer in a way that we didn't see. So We just try to get as much information we can to the contractor and let them do all the screening. But that usually certainly does help with reducing the customer acquisition cost, because it can be a lot of back and forth at the beginning to get all the information you need for the contractor to be able to make a good assessment. And we just try to shorten that as much as possible.
Thanks, Don and Corey. It looks like another question from Kate. Tips for selecting multiple installers and still ensuring that all customers participating in the program have an equivalent experience, or for standardizing the offer to customers? And I know for
the main reason we don't is because it's really hard to do that. We've experimented with it in the past, and we find it's really confusing for customers and installers. Often their offerings, we didn't want to limit what installers could provide. So picking two really creates this challenge of trying to level them together. And then you have to sort of decide who goes where, and then switching people back and forth because they, you know, had a particular installer that their friend worked with. And it's just, it becomes very challenging to administer, as well as confusing for participants, which is generally why we just do one. And if the group is huge and we get a great turnout, which happens a lot, we close it, you know, and then we'll just open up another round and do another RFP for ones that are big enough where one installer can't handle, you know, more than 100, 150 customers. So that's the way that we handle that, is having a successful first round and then doing another one right afterwards.
I just want to add one thing, and I completely agree with Corey as far as the administration and the customer confusion. There is opportunity for a lot of that. But really the biggest reason why we would have one contractor, or sometimes we'll have one contractor for residential and then a second contractor for commercial, depending on the market, is because the whole point is to be able to get those group discounts and to be able to get volume discounts on the materials and the installations. And when you have more than one company sourcing those materials from different places, then you're not going to have as steep of a volume discount as you otherwise would. So that's why we normally have one or sometimes two contractors, depending on how we bifurcate residential and commercial.
Thanks, Don. And I just will quickly answer the other part of Kate's question on differences in an RFP targeted at commercial and residential. The RFP we've developed and the focus for the content today will be on residential, but I'm sure that it sounds like Don and maybe Corey as well could speak a little bit more after the workshop about any commercial differences.
So now we'll look at the next two sections of the RFP, the proposal requirements section and the proposal evaluation section. So just to emphasize what Ryan said, most of this language in these sections is fairly standard. And we've already provided it to you in the template and also a response form, which I'll talk about in a moment. So I'll be providing a brief overview of the kind of more boilerplate content, but I'll spend the most time emphasizing the parts of the RFP that you'll need to think about and customize to your specific scenario. So as the name suggests, proposal requirements, this section of the RFP really specifies what details proposals should include. So our template includes sections on installer qualifications, the format, submission and deadline, the response form and the required attachments, submission recommendations, and then how to ask questions or whom to contact with questions. As part of the RFP, this is a pretty brief section, but it's also where our response form template comes in. So the response form is, at least in our template, and is a standardized Excel spreadsheet that we provide along with the RFP template. I mean, the idea is that when you release the template, you also release the response form, which is what installers will fill out and submit as part of their application along with any other required attachments. So the response form has specific language asking for information that we want from installers. And as in the RFP template, we've provided most of the text and highlighted areas where you need to modify for your local context. Each tab in this spreadsheet covers a category of information we want from bidders. So this includes tabs on business information, pricing, financing, hardware and warranties, the customer service that Solarize participants can expect, additional services such as, you know, energy efficiency, battery storage, roof repair, and also things like community benefits. Again, most of this information shown here is work that we've already done for you and provided in our RFP template and response form, but I'm going to highlight some key decision points and modifications that you'll need to think about before releasing the RFP so that you get the information that you need. So the first is pricing. Corey actually touched upon this in his insights, but with regards to pricing, you'll want to consider whether you are asking for tiered pricing or a single discounted price. So while Solarize campaigns have traditionally asked for lower prices depending on how many customers sign up, some campaigns, including Sun's campaigns, have found it easier to just ask for a single price regardless of how many people sign up. Another thing to consider is the base price that proposers offer versus the final price with cost additions. So the way we typically request RFPs are, and installers propose their pricing, is that they'll propose a base price and then additional prices for different premium additions, such as, you know, high efficiency panels or battery storage or complex roofs. You'll want to think about what you want offered in the base price. And we kind of recommend asking for a single comprehensive base price that includes most things that most people in the campaign will want, and then reserving additional prices really for items that are truly premium. So that's the format that we've provided in the RFP response form, but you might want to include language on what you think is a minimum requirement for that base installation. We're also hoping to incentivize both installers and municipalities to pilot solar app. And the one mechanism we thought of adding in the RFP for that is that we're asking installers whether or how much they would drop their base price if cities use solar app to speed up permitting. And then financing also involves some decisions on the campaign's part. So if you already have financial arrangements made, then you might not have to emphasize this as much, but, you know, alternatively, if you don't, then you'll need to think about how, what the installer provides will count for more. So you'll need to think about how to prioritize that. And then we've also included language in our template for you to ask whether the installer would agree to use Energy Score, particularly if they offer their own financing or third-party ownership mechanism. So that's something that you can ask and see if they'd be interested. Campaign and customer services are also something that you need to think of what you want as part of your campaign, particularly when we're thinking about our LMI customers. So for example, Sun has asked installers in the past to include ongoing and maintenance, the costs of ongoing operations and maintenance in their bid. And in their DC Solar for All program, they've also asked installers include an agreement to remove and reinstall the system once in the first 10 years if the roof needs to be replaced. So those are things to think about. It's also worth asking what specific language capabilities the installer has, depending on the neighborhoods you're targeting. And then there's the additional offering. So in addition to solar photovoltaic, your campaign might wanna focus on things like energy efficiency, roof repair, battery storage, EV chargers, and there may be other services here. So, you know, we've provided the language for all of these, but really include these sections based on your campaign goals, balancing them out with, you know, what you know about from your local solar market. And then finally, we've included questions pertaining to the type of company you want to contract with. So are they local? What are their hiring practices? Are they unionized, minority or woman owned? Do they have experience in the community? So consider which of these questions is important to you and important to your campaign when you're releasing the RFP. So that's kind of an overview of the proposal requirements section and our response form template. So again, we've made this all pretty standard so that our campaigns can release these RFPs and get all the information that you want. You really need to decide, you know, what's important based on your goals, which questions you want to include based on your priorities, and then the rest should hopefully be mostly cutting and pasting. Okay, so now we'll move on to the next section of the RFP, which is the proposal evaluation section. This is where you tell proposers what you value the most and how you're going to rank their applications. This section really ties into previous workshops where we discussed campaign goals, and also ties into the previous section because the information that you asked for is definitely relevant to, you know, what you prioritize the most. So in our template, this section outlines the evaluation process, the evaluation criteria, and the awards and acceptance process. And the evaluation criteria is the part that you'll really want to customize based on your goals. So the way we suggest doing it, and we provide this in the template, is we list a rubric for how we'll grade proposals. And the rubric uses categories that closely correspond to our response form. So we say that each of these categories is worth a certain number of points. And then you can weight these categories according to your proposals, which is kind of shown in this example. The evaluation criteria section can also include descriptions on what you value the most. So, you know, think back to your campaign goals and you know, as you decide what language you want to put in this section, and as you emphasize how you're going to weight your evaluation. Should release the RFP and how to advertise it. So the two remaining topics that I want to focus on relate to which organization. So as we alluded to earlier, a number of cities in this cohort are already working with Sun or Solar Crowdsource or have done this before. But for cities that don't have a technical partner or previous experience, here are some things to think about when deciding who should release the RFP. And the first is your timeline. And as Don alluded to, releasing the RFP as a city will likely take much more time and slow down the process, since the procurement department and legal team will be involved. And I'm sure Don can talk about this a little more because it sounds like it might also limit your options. So that's something you want to think about when deciding who should release the RFP. On the other hand, you want to think about your organization's visibility and outreach. So what we heard from Laura at the Philadelphia Energy Authority of the last few presentations, and Laura mentioned that having the city release the RFP really helped with their outreach because they were able to put the RFP on their official bids page, and it kind of increased the legitimacy of the campaign in the eyes of the installers, and Laura speculated that that really helped them get a better price. And then there's obviously capacity, so you want to think about really just which organizations have the ability to release the RFP and field responses. So that's another one thing to think about. Okay. And then the last thing that I want to touch on. Oops. All right. And then the last thing I want to touch on is ideas for really getting the word out and advertising the RFP once you've written it. It looks like I'm having some issues with moving slides. Let's see. Okay. So working with a solar industry association, a local solar industry or advocacy association, is a really good bet. Ryan and I have recently been speaking to representatives from the Solar Industry Energy Association, which I think is the largest national solar industry association. So working with a local SIA chapter would be a really good option for getting the word out to the installers. And that's something that Ryan and I can probably help put you in touch with. We also recommend contacting your local economic development department or other nearby jurisdictions that have done solar procurement in the past, since they'll likely have channels to reach out to installers. And then definitely if you have individual installers you have in mind who you want to bid on the RFP, contact them and let them know directly that the RFP is out and you want them to bid on them. It shouldn't be too hard to do kind of a quick survey of local installers in your area if you want to reach out to some installers individually. Okay, so with that, I want to open up the floor to Corey and Don again. So maybe Corey and Don, like, I have a few specific questions on things like pricing and how you're really ensuring quality and inspections and things like that. But maybe before we get into that, if you have any additional insights based on this content on the proposal requirements and evaluation section, that'd be great to hear. And maybe Corey, you can go first this time and then Don.
Yeah, that's good. Thanks, good. Thank you. Thanks, Tushar. And I have to say, you know, you and Ryan did a really great job of sort of synthesizing a lot of different proposal templates and evaluation templates. So just, you know, kudos to doing that. It wasn't easy to do that since there's a lot of variation there. So I hope folks realize this is a really valuable resource to see this stuff all in one place like this. A couple of things that maybe to highlight, and I won't drill into each one to make sure we leave enough time, but if folks want to follow up on the proposal requirements part, Tushar mentioned O&M plans. Some other things to consider, especially with inclusivity in mind, is connectivity requirements for monitoring, which often is, you know, internet access in the home is sometimes the first thing to go for folks that are having problems with cash flow. So that's something to require cellular monitoring is one thing. Second thing are product warranty and extensions that you might want to require, or at least make sure in the bid so you can decide whether to include them for certain installations. And then there was a mention about inspections as well. We put something in our agreement with installers that we sort of reserve the right to do third-party inspections on a spot basis. And periodically we'll schedule one or two inspections for a co-op just to make sure things are going well, have those reports come to us. That's another way to sort of just make sure that people are getting a good experience and keeping installers on their toes as much as possible. On the sort of evaluation side, I think it's important to get a sense of who's doing the selecting in this group, whether like us, it's a volunteer group of people who were part of the co-op, or whether it is folks that maybe have a more professional background or at least are part of the city infrastructure in some way, is what are the skill sets and abilities of the people in that group, and making sure you're providing support for folks that maybe are not as familiar with solar, and getting them up to speed in a timely fashion so they can participate fully is important. We do a lot of facilitating and sort of answering questions for selection committees to enable good decision making and to support them regardless of whether they know anything about solar before they come to the meeting. Just the sort of the basics of making sure that you're very careful about checking licenses, checking any other sources of information about reviews for installers, taking that with a grain of salt, but pulling that in, and then really understanding sort of the differences between the warranties that are available. This is something we see for selection groups come back to quite a bit, and understanding the difference between the labor warranties that are available, how they cover things like roof penetrations, and product warranty labor replacements, as well as all the equipment related warranties, like product warranties for panels and inverters, like the production warranties. Those are sort of key decision points that we see a lot. So those are some things that come to mind. I'm sure we'll get other questions as well, but I don't want to take up too much time here. I'll turn it over to Don.
Yeah, the spreadsheet that you had there that has the, I guess where the contractor can put all of their answers and all the information requested is that that's really cool. I might look at that as something that we adopt later on. We're a little bit more, you know, fill out or please answer the things that we're asking for in a narrative form, and then we'll ask them to also attach things like Corey had mentioned, like the spec sheets for materials, which usually has a lot of the technical information on there, as well as warranty information. I mentioned proposals before. We like to see a sample proposal. We also like to look at the contracts. We would ask them to include a copy of the contract as well. We just want to make sure that that the terms of that contract aren't too onerous. And then I'm sure this is in the template, but it might be worth mentioning. We do ask for any of the licensing certification or qualifications that the contractors have, as well as references. We always call on, we ask them for 3 residential and 3 commercial references, and we're sure to call on that. Sometimes we will also ask who their supplier is, who is their distributor. We want to make sure that we're dealing with folks that are in good standing, that are going to be around not just throughout the duration of the campaign, but also, well after that, to honor their workmanship warranties and any operating and maintenance agreements that might take place. It's usually just a quick call to whoever their distributor is, ask if they're in good standing. And we'll do the same thing with a, Secretary of State's office type thing. Just make sure that they are registered to do business in the state and that they're in good standing there as well.
Cool. Yeah, those are a lot of really good points that you both brought up on really ensuring like consumer protection, making sure that everything's good quality. I know I've heard Corey mention this previously, and Don, you mentioned it this time about asking for a template proposal and contract so you can really see that language. And then what Corey touched upon with the actual proposal evaluation, we'll definitely spend more time in a future workshop going into evaluating proposals. So I see there's a few questions that have come up in the chat. I have one more question that I'm gonna ask Corey and Don directly, but in the meantime, feel free to keep adding questions in the chat and we'll try to get to those. But the last question that I have is, could both of you maybe like talk quickly on your thoughts on, asking for a single price versus tiered pricing, go into that a little more, and then also talk about, the base price versus the different cost adders and how you kind of manage that in your contracts. Corey, you could go first again if you want.
Sure. So on the tiered pricing part, there's just to make a distinction, there's sort of two, when we say tiered pricing, there's two different types. One is on the size of the group where the pricing is changing based on the number of people that are in the group. And that one we don't use because it's just confusing for people about whether they're going to have a certain type of pricing based on where they are, as well as what happens if they reach a new level and you have to sort of figure out how to handle folks that have already signed a contract. So we just, based on the length of it, we just find it simpler just to not have it. And we seem to have pretty good pricing regardless. The second one is related to sort of different equipment options, and that we do get a lot of and we welcome, which is different types of equipment that's available. Occasionally you'll see bidders provide different tiers of pricing based on the system size, and that can work. Generally speaking, at least with a group of volunteers, the simpler the pricing arrangement, the easier it is for them to evaluate. So we encourage installers to make it as simple as possible, but we don't restrict it because we want them to have flexibility about how they bid on their product. That's an important distinction on both of those.
Yeah, this is where I guess the models differ a little bit. And I don't want to speak for Sun's model or process, but when we go into a Solarize campaign and we're asking, what is the pricing going to be? We don't know how many people are going to participate. We haven't, gone out and I guess formed that co-op like Sun does, where they have an idea of how many folks that are going to be interested in that particular project. So we do have that tiered pricing model, and we say the more that participate, the greater the savings. And it is a little bit of a tricky explanation at first, but people usually get it pretty quickly when you explain that, the early adopters are going to pay one price at one of the first tiers where the price is going to be higher. And then as more people join the campaign and we aggregate all those materials and installations together, we can get the price lower and lower and lower. And then what really helps, I think, people understand it is that, if you're an early adopter and you're one of the first people who signed a contract for the campaign, well, you're paying that higher price. So, what's the difference? Why wouldn't I wait until the end of the campaign until I know what the pricing is, and then I'll sign a contract. Well, the way we handle that is that there's a rebate involved. So depending on whatever tier pricing we end up in, the selected contractor will cut a rebate check back to the customers who signed up earlier. So everybody pays the same price. It's really important that everybody's kind of rowing the boat together on that. And also the tiered pricing is kind of fun. You know, when you reach another tier and you get to a lower pricing, you get to report back to everybody who signed up for the campaign, and it tends to generate a little bit of excitement. And it kind of adds a little bit of excitement to the campaign. So yeah, we do the tiered pricing and we do it that way. And the base price in the tiered pricing, that is for a full turnkey system. And that includes installation, permitting, inspections, the whole thing. And that's usually for a standard type of home in that community. So if most of the homes in that community are ranch style houses, then that base price will reflect that. And so there might be an adder for homes that are two stories or more, because that might be a more of a complicated installation. OSHA requirements are going to kick in, and they're going to have to be wearing harnesses and ropes, and they might need a lift, you know, to get the panels up there. So we take a look at what's in the community, what kind of homes we'll be servicing, and then we try to model the base price on that. And then the adders will come depending, there's always different site conditions that will dictate the differences in what the ultimate price will be versus what the base price will be. So you want to have your adders in there. You want the bidders to bid on the adders and disclose in advance what that pricing is, and make sure that the customers know what those adders are as well.
Yeah, and that's the same for us on the adders. So we encourage installers to make sure all of those are exposed, and whatever they propose is what's there. So they have to account for things that would vary from the base price, which are essentially what Don has described. There's a bunch of different versions of that, but you want to make sure you have a base price, and then things that are outside of that are identified clearly and understood by participants ahead of time, so there aren't any surprises.
Cool. Yeah, thanks for those reflections. I think, so once again, I've sort of underestimated the time I have. And there, I'm looking at the questions in the chat. I think just to respond, I'll say at the outset that we'll get to all of these questions, even if we don't get to address them right now. There are definitely a few suggestions on, you know, getting advertising, getting the RFP out, and just to respond to the comment about RMI directly, I think we will be trying to work with SIA to see if we can advertise the RFPs, but we'll get back to participants on that. And I think maybe the one question that I would be interested in like hearing Corey and Don's thoughts is Stella's question is, where in the RFP process do you communicate the fact that, you know, residents may need roof repairs or have unpermitted structures or need service panel upgrades? You know, my thoughts are just that we do have, we have asked for what kind of pricing the installers or proposers would offer those services at in our RFP and RFP template. So that's one area. But if Corey and Don, you have other thoughts there.
Yeah, Corey, it sounds like you guys may specify that more than we do. We during our education and outreach and our town halls and our workshops and things, we do talk about recommendations depending on the age of the roof and the condition of the roof, whether they should go ahead and replace the roof first, or at least that portion under the solar. And you know, generally, if your roof is 5 years or sometimes even 10 years or younger, depending on the material, then it's okay to do it, to go ahead and put the solar on there. But if it's older than 10 years, then that's when the site evaluation will kick in. There'll be a closer look at the roof and a determination will be made at that time. We do get that question all the time. what if I need to get my roof replaced? How much is that going to cost? And we do not ask for that question up front in the RFP. It's a good suggestion and something that we might consider moving forward, but it's usually addressed during one of our educational workshops for those folks who are really interested in what that might cost.
Most of the questions we have are part of our standard RFP. The ones where there may be a lower moderate income component to the co-op, we add a few that where we just require the pricing, like the ones I mentioned earlier about cellular connectivity, roof replacement, repair and replacement, we ask anyways, extended warranties, and then we will sometimes also ask whether they do basic structural repairs for roofs, just to know whether we can include that in the installer engagement, or whether that's something that has to be outsourced or maybe connected to a city program if there's one available. But all of the electrical upgrades and things are part of the normal RFP. And as a matter of fact, when we've done these, the one we did in DC, we found we did run into a number of people who needed spot repairs on their roof in order for it to work, and also like some type significant electrical upgrades. And because of the funding, we were able to support that, but we would have otherwise lost some people. We had one person who needed like a full electric service replacement. And the only way they even knew that was a problem was because the installer came on site and said, I can't do this unless we do this too. And we were able to do it, but that required that there to be a budget line for us to be able to support that. So you just want to ask those questions, know what the cost is, and then you got to figure out whether you can cover it or whether that's a gateway for people who are in that situation to not participate.
Pause. Okay, so in the last minute we have here, just some quick next steps for the cohort. We'd really like you to prioritize developing the RFP. So finish drafting either the Solarize RFP, or if you're working with Solar United Neighbors, just making sure that that's good to go. And as you're doing that, reviewing the workshop resources on our webpage, as I've noted in the past. As you're working on this and previous deliverables as well, feel free to reach out to us with any questions that come up and update that tracker that we've been using in our check-in calls. Lastly, our fifth workshop is going to be next month on January 20th. So RSVP for that. And we're looking forward to having you then. So that's it for us. I'll stay on for up to half an hour for any additional remaining questions. But that's it for us, and thanks everyone for joining.